Okay, perfect. So thanks again, everyone. We're really, I mean, panel after panel, really excited about everyone who's volunteered their time, so gracious. This is the fourth panel. This panel is on impact investing. And the moderator is John Jones, who is the Chief Investment Officer and Social Impact GM at GSV Labs. He raises, manages, and deploys the GSV Labs Investment Fund. He also sets the impact strategy both within the GSV Lab community and externally for the broader ecosystem. Prior to joining GSV Labs, John was the founding CEO of Vendry and Marcosa. He spent 12 years leading sales, marketing, and customer success teams at high-growth technology companies, including Level 3 Communications, where he managed a $100 million business unit focused on global network and business intelligence solutions. John received his BA in economics and statistics from the University of California, Davis, and his MBA from Wharton, the Wharton School at UPenn, and obviously out of this exec's Wharton SF program. He was the class speaker, so if anyone from Wharton would love to touch out, reach out, he'd love that, and he's been a great champion for the entire Wharton community. With that, I will turn it over and let him introduce the rest of the panel. Thanks, John.
Thanks, Kayvon. All right, so this should be a fun panel. I've got three new panelists. I was on the panel last year. I think I spent too much time answering questions, so they told me this year just to ask them. Katie has experience with me grilling her with questions, so she's the veteran of the crew. We'll do a quick introduction with Kunal from Capricorn, Katie from Amidiar. Nelson's here representing the Adidas family office, as well as Declara. And we've got Victoria from Village Capital. So I'm really excited about the panel. I like to start with a fun fact from everyone. I'm actually going to let the team introduce themselves, and then we'll jump into the panel. We'll just go, I think, my left to right, if that works. Kunal, you want to say a fun fact about yourself, and then maybe a little bit about what you do at Capricorn?
Sure. Thanks, John. Fun fact about myself. I went to college to major in theater. I wanted to join Broadway. Then I ended up in investment banking. I don't know how.
Hamilton is looking for coming to San Francisco.
And now I'm here. I work at Capricorn Investment Group, which is a part of Jeff Skoll's family office. We do a variety of different, impact investments within the nonprofit space, movie making, infrastructure, healthcare. I focus on the venture capital team, and we mostly focus on technology impact investments.
Thank you. Katie.
Great. I'm Katie Broth. I work at Omidyar. I work with Elaine, who was on a panel earlier today, and am in our investment management team. So we work across the portfolio, doing things like sitting on investment committee, helping think through structuring, and also getting involved in some of our more experimental outgrowths as we grow our scope of activities. My fun fact is, up until about 3 years ago, I was Canadian for 3 years and then dramatically had my passport cut up in front of me. So if you want to hear more about that drama, feel free to grab me afterwards.
Are you trying to run back to Canada? This is
the rumor? Mean, it's something I need to look into.
Katie also, I've gotten lots of fun facts from Katie. She also speaks, I think, 7 languages?
No.
Have you learned a new one since we met last?
No. I speak 4, but...
4.
John.
Nelson.
I'm Nelson Gonzalez. Since I'm representing the founding family of the Adidas company, I had to pick a sporty fact. So a while ago, I actually ran down the west coast of New Zealand. It took me a month and a half, and it was really fun to spend the night in sheep farms and dairy farms. So I can show you pictures if you want. So the Adidas family office has created something called LEED, which is a very interesting fund connected to an accelerator. And we're thinking a lot about how to innovate on practices in impact investing, particularly in the health and wellness and sports arena. But we're also thinking about how to connect a fund to an accelerator that looks at what we call the full stack innovation ecosystem that's required for startups to succeed. So everything from founder supports to team supports to how to get really good methodologies in product development, go-to-market strategies, as well as a blend of capital types. And so we're thinking very holistically about how to help our company succeed. I've also been on the other side of the table as the founder of Declara, a venture-funded Silicon Valley enterprise collaboration platform.
Awesome.
Hi, everybody. I'm Victoria Fram. I'm the co-founder of VilCap Investments, which is an early seed stage fund that's affiliated with Village Capital. And it's great to see here some of the entrepreneurs we've worked with or people who have been partners with us in the audience. Village Capital is a system to find, train, and fund in entrepreneurs solving real-world problems. And we do the investing piece of it through a peer selection process where we actually have the entrepreneurs themselves evaluate each other, and that determines how we allocate the first checks that we write. So happy to talk about how that works a little bit more in practice, but we've been doing it for about 6 years now, have made 70 investments through this model, and are really excited about the results that we're seeing. The fun fact about me combines a little bit of the performing arts aspect with some of the athletic endeavors. So I am an amateur aerial fabrics artist, which is like the wow. Cirque du Soleil kind of performing. And so I probably grew up with a similar ambition of wanting to do something that is ends up being very different from actually what I spend my day-to-day job doing, which is trying to figure out how to get capital to really passionate and impactful entrepreneurs.
Take the show on the road.
Thanks, Victoria. All right, so we're here at the Wharton Social Impact Conference. We actually have a kind of a for-profit filter on this panel. And Katie, I'm going to open up with you. What is impact investing? I think a lot of the folks in the audience, if we ask the 120 people who are here, probably all have different definitions. How do we think about this?
Wow, that's like, thank you for giving me a small question. Yeah, I mean, it's no secret, obviously, that within this room, as you said, there's hundreds of different perspectives. I think even within Omidyar, actually, we have some different perspectives. And, you know, largely, it is the idea that you can do good and, you know, do economically well, be impactful, and get financial return at the same time in the for-profit space. We actually think about investing more broadly. I think Elaine spoke earlier about, to some extent, our systems approach, so how we think about the nonprofit levers and the for-profit levers. So I would say two things. One is that you know, we really believe that impact has to come from using both those for-profit and nonprofit tools. So we take the most expansive approach you probably can take in defining impact investing. And it's a little bit different how we think about it for-profit, nonprofit. And within our fund, we have, you know, five different investment initiatives. So financial inclusion, education, emerging technology, governance, citizen engagement, property rights. And each of them thinks about how they measure that and think about that a little differently. And also how much is more for-profit oriented, nonprofit oriented. I'm going to harken back to, I think Elaine mentioned this returns continuum document, which is kind of the girding that we put over the whole organization for how we think about it on, from a combined approach, but there's lots of variability underneath. So it's a little bit of a dodge.
That was a little bit of a dodge. You've obviously been on a panel with me before. I'm going to actually, Kunal, I'm going to ask you the next question. The reason being impact investing is a relatively new term, maybe the last 5 years or so. At Capricorn, you were one of the original impact investors before the word even existed between your investments in Tesla and SpaceX. Speaking of which, Elon Musk is a Wharton grad, so if you can help us get him back here next year, that would be fantastic. But talk to us about Capricorn's investment philosophy, going from being one of the original impact investors before anybody knew what it was, to now impact investing being cool. How do you define your investment strategy with respect to impact?
Sure. That's always a challenge. I think we measure it, we define it in the sense that as long as we still expect outstanding returns from new businesses that can enable, you know, environmental and social change. Now, if that definition is too much fluff, narrow it down and focus on how is it directly reducing carbon emissions, or how are you reducing or redirecting resource innovation, right? Because if you're reducing resource utilization or making more environmentally friendly, you're creating an impact. Mm-hmm. So if you want to zoom in on your model, get those two facts down, and we measure impact that way. Some of the big name dropping ones are, yes, you can look at Tesla, you can look at SpaceX, right? Opening up space exploration or having, you know, investing in the largest electric vehicle out there. But that doesn't mean we've invested in waterless toilets. We've invested in baby warmer technology. To us, each of those sort of measure impact in a different way. And we'll still want to continue to invest in companies like that. Is that
okay? Good. Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Victoria, you come from a little bit, I know you classify your firm as an investment firm, but you're actually kind of an accelerator, incubator. Can you give us, in terms of context, what that looks like? And then what's the filter you apply to your companies? Are you filtering for impact? Are you filtering for for-profit? And are those aligned, or is there some tension there?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, we do think of it as a system, and some of the sort of entrepreneurial team support, ecosystem support pieces, when we're working with really early stage companies, we've found that we need to do both. So it's not just the capital support they need by us writing a really early stage check. There's actually a lot of fundamental pieces that they're still thinking through about their business model, about what their founding team looks like, about how they will think about tapping into the right sources of human capital and sort of where they need to fit in a supply chain to eventually achieve the impact that they're targeting. So we've found that really the system was born out of a single family office that wanted to make impact investments and was seeing in sort of a traditional format hundreds of deals come across their desks every year and saying, we don't have the bandwidth to diligence these, and frankly, a lot of them are probably too early stage to actually accept our capital. But if we had a process that could get them to a place where we'd feel comfortable writing a check, we think we would make better investments because we would have a little bit more insight into whether they'll be able to absorb that capital, and we would feel better about the fact that, you know, at current stage, with only a few investment professionals, we're only going to write a few checks a year. We have to find a way to make this a more efficient process. And that's where the peer selection component comes in. That was actually like taking a page out of the book of what enabled microfinance to scale, which is if you leverage some of the social capital that exists in groups that can sort of leapfrog some of the visibility or information you would need about an individual by relying instead on social fabrics or visibility that they may have in a group setting, could you accelerate the pace at which you could deploy capital? And that's what we're finding in the groups of entrepreneurs that we bring together in our accelerator cohorts. I think in terms of whether we see a trade-off in terms of impact and for-profit companies, we exclusively work with for-profit companies. And we must believe that the impact that they are seeking to have is fundamentally integrated in their business model, so that at the same time as they operationally scale and have success, we are going to see a commensurate scaling in the impact they achieve. So we tend to not like models that kind of can bifurcate. We're going to make a lot of money over here, and over here we're going to return some of it to the community that we work in, or sort of concessionary products or services that we'll sell at a discount, because the concern for us is you might be really good at the first piece and all of a sudden the second piece sort of falls off the radar. So we look to ensure that both on the founding team and in how their model exists, those two are married pretty well.
So your peer selection process is pretty unique in that the teams are effectively your investment committee, right?
Right.
So your ability to be squishy with investment decisions is kind of taken away, in that you probably have to hand these teams criteria. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about that and how that works and whether it works? Now that you're 6 years in, you probably have some outcome data.
Yeah, and we certainly, it does not look today as it looked in those first cohorts. I think it was a lot messier in the early ones where we didn't have a lot of process built around it. So now, having done this through cohorts about 50 times, it's a very streamlined and transparent process that they go through. So multiple times throughout the cohort, they evaluate each other against our criteria, which has now evolved into 9 categories on which they measure each other's potential and ROI prospects. And that's really to try to frame their decision making not in the sort of immediately evident traction or results that they've been able to demonstrate so far, but where you think this company could go with an investor's lens. So we've made 70 investments using this peer selection process. Over 90% of them are still surviving, and we're 6-7 years in almost. Out of those 70, we've realized 10 exits. We have another 10 that are partially realized. And we're finding what I think is some of the most interesting data for us, which is our portfolio looks a lot different than traditional early stage or venture portfolios. So whereas we're seeing, you know, the vast majority of venture funding go to a few small communities. About half of the global venture funding goes to three regions in the US, Silicon Valley, Massachusetts, and New York. The inverse is actually true in our portfolio. So the vast majority of our portfolio is in cities that aren't those three in the US, and then globally in markets elsewhere in the world. We're also finding that when we give entrepreneurs the decision-making power, we're getting more diverse results. So almost 40% of our portfolio are female founders, almost 20% of it are founders of color. So again, very different than the less than 10% of capital you're seeing go to female founders generally, and less than 1% that you're seeing go to founders of color.
Great, fantastic. Nelson, I love your experience in that you've been an entrepreneur who's raised, I think, $38 million more or less at Declara. You've been an innovation consultant from everyone from other startups to the president of, I think, Columbia. And now you're helping the Adidas family office really set up their strategy for impact. Unlike Kunal and Capricorn, where that didn't really impact, didn't really exist when they started, they just kind of naturally had an affinity for that. How do you talk to us about helping set up a strategy for impact and making a difference and setting it up from scratch, knowing what we know over the last 5 to 7 years of impact?
Yeah, it's a great question. And in conversations with the family office and other investors in this space, what I've seen is that the mainstreaming of impact investing is accelerating quite rapidly. And I've been surprised what I've been hearing over the last few months. Some of the most sophisticated entrepreneurs in the space are basically saying things like, oh, no, I don't want to be part of an impact fund because that seems almost like a consolation prize. I want to be part of the real fund, right? And so there's this sort of almost like a view that if you're doing impact, you're not going to be held to as rigorous a bar as other companies, that there'll be the exits will be lower, they'll take longer. And so there's this interesting tension, I think, in terms of how you attract the absolute best entrepreneurs in any field to think about impact, and also how you think about concessions and for other investors in terms of time and also return. And increasingly, certainly at family office and with some of our emerging LPs, we are coming to a mind that we shouldn't really talk about impact, we should just do it, and we should concede nothing, that we should basically have a full-on market-driven a fund that absolutely looks at double and triple bottom lines and thinks about the goal of entrepreneurs and what their values are and what they're trying to achieve, but have that be a kind of lens that you would look at beyond the company and the metrics and the potential of for market. So it's been interesting to see that as we jump in on the shoulders of a lot of amazing work that's been done, the mainstreaming of impact investing has accelerated a lot. The other thing that we're seeing is that there is a need for players to fill in what I'm beginning to see as kind of the missing middle of the impact field, because you've got kind of the founders of the movement like Omidyar and others that have really created an infrastructure to help take very, very seriously complex problems. I mean, you need to be almost a social scientist to be sort of good enough to make investments in public health and governance and education, and that's rightly so. These are complex issues and they need to be understood as such. But it's very hard to scale that kind of engagement and to have exits of the kind that, with my other hat as the co-founder of a Silicon Valley company, where my Sand Hill Road investors expect certain multiples. And if I then put on my impact hat, all of that changes, and that's beginning to be less acceptable. And so how do we get to a place where the earnestness of impact investing is seen as a value, but never gets in the way of the kinds of returns that you need? On the other hand, you've got so many big boys and girls from Wall Street and other places entering the field, basically putting lipstick on very old products and doing it to retain talent, to retain clients, to do marketing, to get the millennial assets. But they're doing no innovation, and a lot of it, frankly, is pretty sloppy. Mm-hmm. And so you've got a lot of earnestness, a lot of sophistication, and in the middle, a desperate need for 30 million plus tranches of capital, for mezzanine debt, for mm-hmm. debt for liquidity financing. Very sophisticated things that not many impact investors are sophisticated enough to do, but that many of the investors sophisticated enough to do them, they don't really have the lens to understand mm-hmm. whether this is actually going to fulfill the 5 to 10 year road that an impact investor has been on. So mainstreaming and this missing middle of sophisticated investment chops with a very deep and rigorous impact lens. That's where we're trying to figure out how to learn a lot and hopefully soon add some value.
You talked a little bit about mainstreaming impact investing, and it sounds like in a lot of cases that means just removing the impact investing terminology from your language as an investor, whether that's positioning yourself as solving big problems or investing in mission-driven entrepreneurs. Talk a little bit about that. I think Obvious Ventures does a really good job on not self-identifying as impact, but really talking about it in that way. And there are a lot of entrepreneurs here today, several of them I know personally, who feel like they're socially driven, but how do you go approach an investor and say, I have a great business, and oh, by the way, I have a strong impact? Is it oh, by the way, is it tied in? How do you talk about that?
Yeah, I think it's product first, it's market first. I think what we're seeing is we're gonna leave the word impact out. We're finding that often the best entrepreneurs see that as maybe second best. And some of the investors that we want to bring in, particularly when you're representing a brand like Adidas and Adi Dassler, who's the founder of Adidas, who has an incredible life story, the people in that orbit expect to play, you know, in a space where things are going to be understandable. And often when you try to bring in investors that are used to very traditional term sheets and industry analyses, things get very murky because obviously one of the things we haven't learned how to do well together yet is put real measurements underneath the multiple bottom line. So when things get very murky, entrepreneurs and investors get a bit scared. And so we're wondering how to mainstream this so that we're basically leaving that out. But having a lens that says, unless you are committed to demonstrable impact in health and wellness and the kind of human development that happens through sport, and you're doing it in a way that is going to demonstrate that, we're not interested, but we're basically going to leave conversations that aren't about building a great product and having that capture a piece of the market kind of out of the conversation. So it's a hypothesis that we're gonna test about being a little bit more radically market focused. We'll see what we learn.
Okay, good. So Katie Nelson talked a little bit about timing and what the market looks like today. Mm-hmm. Midyear is one of the leaders in terms of investing, in terms of impact. What is the current economic and political landscape? How does that affect what's happening, or does it at all? And I know I'm gonna give you all
it's
the
two
hard
for
questions.
Two. You know, one of the amazing things about working at Omidyar is it is a complex institution. We have, as I said, five different initiatives. We work globally in almost every region of the world. And so the answer to that question is complex. But if I just narrow the scope to the US, you know, we have a handful of strategies that really focus on the US right now: US education, US financial inclusion, and governance and citizen engagement, which includes things like independent media, fact-checking. And so certainly one of the, you know, the first thing is for us to take a step back and say, what does all of this mean for how we think about the strategies that we have today? And I think that that's where we're most likely to see some evolution of our strategies. So fact-checking, we've already made a handful of investments in fact-checking in Africa. We a fact-checking organization in South America, and you know, how do we think about that in this landscape in the U.S.? So things that we previously took for granted as part of the landscape, we have to reevaluate. I think that that's going to be true certainly in education as we see what policies are rolled out, and financial inclusion in other areas as well. You know, additionally, because we have such flexible tools. Again, I think we have a unique advantage that we're able to actually open the aperture a little more and say, you know, is there anywhere else that we're not looking today that we may want to consider looking at if we take a larger systems approach to thinking about empowerment, which is one of our fundamental values. So I think for now, it's going back to strategy and reassessing that strategy against a new and changed reality, but then also thinking about where the new opportunities arise from that.
It sounds like, though, at the core, the strategy is the same, and these are ancillary considerations, since there's a global view and global exposure?
Yeah, I mean, I think our values will remain the same, and I think our values already speak to the complexities that we're seeing unfold in the world and some of the barriers that are gonna come with that. So empowerment as one of our central values. Empowerment is going to be increasingly important in this landscape in the U.S. I think, how you then go back to thinking about that system and what the impediments are to success and the levers and sort of jumping points to success, those I think have changed. And so it is not, on the whole, I think actually our strategies are the right ones for thinking about the complex problems in the world that have evolved as a result of the political landscape. But how we think about where we pull them is gonna be different.
Okay, good. Kunal, I'm gonna ask you a quick question, then I'm gonna open it up to make sure that the audience has a chance to pick on everyone's thought leadership here. Your company is known as a clean tech investor. I know there are a lot of clean tech initiatives. We just appointed somebody with deep oil interests as the energy secretary. Does that affect how you think about outcomes or potential outcomes?
Yes, we've definitely started thinking about it. but the way the sector works is that it's not like a private equity model where we're thinking of a 3-5 year exit, right? We're thinking of this in the long term. Most of the portfolio companies we hold on to, we babysit them for over a decade, right? One of our first investments was Tesla. We still haven't fully exited from it because that's just the way we look at it. We believe in long-term value creation. So we're even thinking of the clean tech space. In the past 5 years, if you average out, there's been there's been a significant amount of investment. Last year itself was over $300 billion, right? Mm-hmm. And we're gonna see that grow over the next 10 years. If you look at Goldman Sachs last year acquired a firm called Imprint Capital that focuses on impact investments. This week itself, Bill Gates and a couple other entrepreneurs founded Breakthrough Energy Ventures, which is looking to invest $1 billion plus in fighting climate change through technology innovation and energy innovation. We definitely think, we don't know for sure what the political climate's going to be like, right? But that doesn't mean the global stance beyond the United States, whether it's a Copenhagen 22 summit or our 2-degree goal to hit, or our goal as Capricorn, in fact, has changed. Because when we invest in companies, yes, political environments and subsidies matter, but we're looking at the return, we're looking at the impact it's generating, and for us, that hasn't changed, and neither will it change in the next 10 years.
Okay, good. Good answer to a tough question. I'm actually going to open it up. Is there anybody out here who has questions for the panel?
They struggle to find deal flow. So I'm curious as to what your interpretations are from that and potentially how your organization is helping fill that gap, or if you know anyone that is leading the way, and what ideas really help bridge the gap between the people with the money and the people who want the money.
How does the money and the idea, how do the money and the ideas find each other?
I mean, I'm happy to talk a little about that. I don't know that we see a lot in our pipeline. So we see a lot of ideas. I think the challenge with every organization, and this is a real pain point for entrepreneurs, is finding the language that aligns with the intention of the investor, right? And especially in the impact space, I think that's especially challenging because so many impact investors lead from a place of an outcome, a desired outcome, and then therefore the investments that lead to that outcome. Not everybody. I think there's not a quorum on this panel, but I think there are many who have pretty clearly defined strategies and the levers that they're looking to pull within that strategy. And so sometimes you can have a great entrepreneur, a really great business model, but it doesn't fit with strategy, and that can be the point of misalignment. At Omidyar, we have some flex outside of our strategies to do experimental investing, where we see a really great entrepreneur who has a really great idea. It's on mission, but it's not necessarily on strategy, and we don't want to miss those opportunities, so we have some flexibility. Not every organization does, and it's certainly something we talk a lot about, learning and experimentation, how we can evolve internally, and I, I, you know, I hope more foundations and impact investment vehicles will take that perspective, because I think that's one solution to solving the capital mismatch or interest mismatch.
And I don't know what, if you are an entrepreneur, or what your business might be working on, but one of the things that I think we have really tried to focus on in our program is like elucidating some of that gap. So very frequently, I think entrepreneurs are extremely frustrated that they pitch and pitch and pitch and don't actually ever know why they're hearing no from people. Many investors simply don't have the time to give detailed feedback to entrepreneurs, or they just are very uncomfortable with being honest with them. And so one of the things that we have found to be really successful in the peer review process that we run is that entrepreneurs very often are hearing for the first time why they're hearing no from people. Because there's a certain level of social reciprocity that happens when you are willing to be vulnerable as an entrepreneur with people who are fighting all the same battles that you are and know exactly how hard it is to run a business. For them to say, like, here are your blind spots. These are the parts of your story that people are not buying. And if you are going to get them to buy into your vision of what the world could be, you need to fill these gaps, or you need to, you know, become more self-aware about the pieces that are not resonating with people. So very often people will apply to our programs thinking that they're doing it in pursuit of the investment and end up coming away with a lot more value in the feedback that we get from actually having some of that, what was previously not transparent, become more transparent to them about why they're not making progress.
Or we don't want to go on record as having said Uber was a dumb idea.
Just quickly on that, earlier this year I was advising a really large fund, $300 billion, that had this idea. They thought there isn't enough intermediation and they wanted to do something about that. And we were able to do a pretty comprehensive analysis of how this worked. And what we found is that there wasn't an obvious problem in either deal flow or people finding money, that the networks were pretty robust. And we basically came back to them and said, well, here's the data. We actually don't think that's as much of a problem as you think it is. So it's interesting that we found that the networks tend to work. The problem is diversity. And this is where I think Village Capital is so critical. If you don't live in New York, Boston, or you know, it's Palo Alto, too bad. If you don't belong to one of the obvious clubs, you fill in the blanks, just pull up any. I was so funny. When I was raising money for my company, I left my laptop open because I was going to go do a pitch on Sand Hill Road. And my partner walked in the kitchen and he said, "What is that? Are you going to a frat party tonight?" And I just said, "What?" And he was serious. He was like, "What is that? Like, are you going to talk to a fraternity tonight?"
Is this the team page of the venture capital?
The team page of the venture capital firm I was going to pitch for that later that day. So the clubs are very, very real, and they're actually. And so that's the issue: is it's a very efficient market if you happen to get into that. What do we do about the middle of the country? What do we do about people who come from different perspectives? What do we do about demystifying people who actually have an impact lens, right? Even though we're saying, like, don't use impact, we care deeply about it, but how do you demystify it? So there's a huge it's an incredibly serious diversity issue. But thankfully, I think the markets are pretty efficient, and so at a macro level, I think I'd be happy to share the data. It works pretty well.
Good. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ami, and I work for another impact investing fund called Radical Impact Partners. Victoria, I was very fascinated by this statement, and this is kind of piggybacking off of what you guys were just talking about, but I was really fascinated with what you had said about how the peer review process, you know, how you guys have funded like 20% of the companies that you have funded have been people of color, and you know, I can't remember if you said half had been women
40%,
entrepreneurs.
But it
was a high percentage, and I guess addresses. Or could provide a lot of insight into some of like the implicit bias in our current capital system and how people are able to or not able to obtain capital. So I guess I was just interested to hear more insight about about those statements, and if you guys have studied that further, like whether your pipeline looks similar to the pipeline of, you know, more traditional VCs or even impact funds, and then, you know, whether you're seeing like more women or people of color coming to Village Capital specifically because they're shut out of other capital systems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for that question. So I think there's a couple different levels, and it's hard to exactly disintermediate what's happening, but one is certainly that we have taken, as a team approach, a much more proactive effort to build our pipeline, and that's with great partners like KPOR, and I saw Frida earlier, I think she's about to speak, who are extremely invested in changing what the sort of initial pool of prospective entrepreneurs looks like. So part of it is getting the right pipeline to begin with, and then as we actually get those highly qualified and high potential entrepreneurs into our program, changing how the decision-making process works. So I think what we really over-index on in the process is that you have to demonstrate that you are going to be able to set achievable goals and execute on them throughout the 3 or 4 months that we work with you. So a lot of the focus is on setting hypotheses, coming back, reporting on those hypotheses, resetting them, demonstrating progress again in between each of the sessions that we run. And incidentally, one of the things that we've found is that men on average tend to be better at charismatically doing a 3-minute pitch on stage. Women on average tend to be much better at actually setting goals that they are going to meet in the next 2 weeks before the cohort comes back again. And anecdotally, our portfolio of female-founded ventures is more profitable and still about half, has raised half as much capital as the male founders. So if you think about if they were sort of fully capitalized, what could they achieve in the fact that they're already running, you know, ventures that are generating more EBITDA than our male-founded enterprises? So I think one of the things that we've found is that when you are typically having a founder go in and pitch an investment committee at a venture fund, they're doing the 3-minute charismatic on stage thing. And if you're a female founder that is running a tremendous enterprise and may not be as sort of confident in selling it, you may not do as well in that pitch, but you would do a lot better with the capital if you actually got the chance to receive it. One of the things that we have found levels the playing field is when entrepreneurs are evaluating each other, they're already so skeptical of each other and sort of cut to the quick about whether you actually are as good as you say you are, that they're much more focused on what are the results that you've actually demonstrated. So rather than, I think Paul Graham famously said, like, I could be fooled by any guy that looks like Zuckerberg in a hoodie, they are less reliant on that story and sort of envisioning what the future trajectory looked like for a founder they may have seen before and sort of relying on pattern recognition and more reliant on, do I actually trust that this founder has demonstrated to me that they can execute and know their customer and will continue to execute in the future? Mm-hmm.
Katie, implied in that question was also a question about measurement, mm-hmm. and a lot of the work being done in impact is how do you measure it?
Yeah.
How do you, though, take a lot of the metrics and KPIs that you want to associate with impact and not impose them on a company in a way that's distractive to their business model?
Yeah. I think a few panelists today have referenced the idea that their fund is really focused on impact being embedded in the model, and I think that really is key to making that easier for everybody, because then it really does become about, you know, for us, we use the term reach. So how many customers are you reaching? And it looks a lot more, to some extent, like traditional venture metrics. You're looking at the operating statistics as a benchmark for the impact. We also, though, and so the reporting, the intensity on the entrepreneur, I think in that respect is neutral versus traditional funding sources. We also try to kind of come up a layer for not all of our investments, but some of our investments, to think about the reach of impact beyond the customer base, but into ecosystems. So particularly, I think a good example of this is in our financial inclusion investing. We're thinking not only about specific, you know, money lenders or different mobile money operators, which are really direct-to-consumer experiences, but also, you know, interesting KYC or digital ID technologies. Those are really a layer up of impact. And so how many customers is that enabling in the ecosystem? Or you know, how many replication companies is that enabling as a result of easing some of those tensions and barriers? So I think we look at impact on two layers and two dimensions. One is really at the company level or the organization level, who are they directly touching and reaching, and then a layer up, what's happening in the ecosystem overall as a result of that.
Okay, good. I think we probably have time for one more question, then we'll let the panelists go. Anybody? There we go.
Hi, my name is Claire, and I am a student at Berkeley Haas. I was wondering, specifically, Nelson, you mentioned sort of a need for a middle ground between social scientists and sort of the investor mindset. And I'm curious how you, as an investor, are trying to address that for anyone on the panel.
So we're trying to address it through every part of the design of the fund, from how we hire a team, people who have sophisticated financial backgrounds but are able to have conversations about theories of change and, you know, behavior change and whatever it is that we're actually measuring, but also the way that we structure our own hypotheses. And one of the things that I think is missing, particularly in impact but generally, is that investors tend to be a little bit too agnostic about their industries when they're trying to figure out what impact they want to have, either in terms of social impact or returns. For instance, in education, we know exactly what makes the most difference for kids. It's about reading at age level by grade three. It's about middle school math, mm-hmm. the high school to middle school to high school transition, and literacy in the fields. Mm-hmm. I have yet to see a single ed tech fund that has ever said, this is our thesis. Our thesis is usually about ed tech or mm-hmm. about gaming or about you know, something sexy about the technology, but nothing about actual learning outcomes. And so by saying as a fund, and let's say we're gonna do something about sports or athletics and the way that we want to further that for different populations, if there are pressure points in the value chain of impact for the beneficiary and or for the investor, we need to make that very explicit as investors, because then we can draw a lot of capital to bear, because we can aggregate capital from different investors, signal to the field that if you do that or this, you're going to have outsized returns for your learners in the case mm-hmm. of education. But oh, by the way, in the case of education again, there are billions of dollars of buyers in states, districts, and schools that are willing to buy things that are actually going to make a difference in learning. So you have aggregated purchasing power, you have aggregated investor capital, and you're gonna, you know, I've been an entrepreneur, you know, we spend a lot of time, usually our first year and a half, going, where do I go? You know, what does my product really do? What problem am I trying to solve? If an investor actually says, you're interested in reading by, you know, by grade level at age three, great, here are some sub options there. You've accelerated 18 months of painful wandering in the desert, right? Trying to find my product market fit. So it's hiring the team, but I think it's also having a really strong sense of what are we trying to achieve, and having a point of view about the system, about the market, about the value chain, about what the research base says, and putting our capital behind that, and then hoping that that we can align the supply and demand sides around that. And then that sort of forces you to have both a sophisticated kind of a social science lens, but a very rigorous investor perspective as well.
Okay, great. Well, Kayvon, thanks for inviting us out, and to the Wharton crew for having us. Victoria, Nelson, Katie, Kunal, thank you very much.
Cool, thank you.